There's a light in the sky, rising in the air. There's a feeling so strong. It's time to light the fire. Like a bright shining light.
Learn.
Getting more out of life.
Love.
Sharing time with friends.
Feeling so strong.
Hello and welcome to the House of Wellness. And welcome also to the colourful Joe Stanley. That's colourful by nature, I have to say. Joe, good to see you again.
I hope you weren't referring to my colourful language.
Colourful dress. Everything's colourful about you today.
Colourful is good. I will take that. We're surrounded by autumnal colours at the moment as the leaves are dropping. Some gorgeous sunny days, but very crisp mornings here in Melbourne. It's beautiful.
Yeah, one of my favourite times of the year. And a reminder, the colder days are ahead, Joe. But to get you warmed up, we've got a stack of winter warmers heading your way. Hinesy gives us the good oil on fish. Plus, we'll serve up a natural remedy for sore throats that anyone can make at home, even me, Joe.
Wow. Like it or not, our increased reliance on technology is the way of the world, and it's the world our kids are growing up in. Find out how to juggle the virtual and the real world with your kids.
We'll also bring you an Aussie dad's incredible story of surviving cancer via a pioneering treatment.
And it is one of the life's greatest mysteries. Why do we put two socks into the wash, yet only one comes out? Well, one Aussie company has the perfect solution for the eternal single sock dilemma. We must be tackling the big issues today, Darcy.
Yeah, well, that is true. And a little later, we'll investigate what life is going to look like post the coronavirus. Interesting times ahead, given the world we've come out of.
Yeah, coronavirus meant a rocky end to term one in the nation's schools and a transitional start to term two. Kids around the country are now either back in the classroom or about to be.
I think everyone agrees that homeschooling was a steep learning curve for us all. Apart from getting the kids into a routine and getting them to do the work, it was also a test of our own, or my own, limited ability. I have to say, when you're getting stumped by Year 4 geography, Joe, that was a bit of a concern for me at times.
Don't even get me started on Year 5 maths. A disaster. So those challenges were amplified for families of students with special needs. Melbourne's Waratah Special Development School teaches kids with intellectual disabilities and has been working really hard to make sure each of their students' individual needs are met while learning from home.
Waratah Special Developmental School is a school for students that have moderate to severe intellectual disability. A lot of the students also have either an autism diagnosis or might have a physical disability. So quite complex needs.
There are 70 students at Waratah, and each of them have unique ways of communicating and engaging with school.
All of our students are individuals. They've all got their individual personalities, and it just takes a little bit more time and effort to understand that. The transition to remote learning was a challenge, and we had to really think quickly and about how we could individualise what we were providing to meet the needs of not only the students but the families.
When it came time to start school from home, a one-size-fits-all solution was never an option.
The teachers put together kits for each student that's tailored for their needs, and those boxes all get put on the bus and delivered to the students. And one parent commented that it's like a care package coming home every Friday.
Here we go.
Thank you.
The kits contain everything from worksheets and sensory materials to exercise balls for the students' physiotherapy. Students like Alice, who have access to technology, are also able to meet their teachers online.
For some of the students, they will watch a pre-recorded lesson and engage with that. But for others, they really need to have that one-on-one connection with the teacher. And it's just amazing how the teachers are so skilled at responding and ad-libbing depending on how the students are responding, and just the lengths that they go to engage the students, dressing up and using masks and props and sparklers and all sorts of things to engage the students.
That's right, Alice!
While it's not quite the same as school, the web lessons have also given Alice a much-needed social outlet.
I think there's a lot of students who have missed interacting with their friends, and you know, by joining into a WebEx lesson, you can at least see some of your friends and have a little bit of communication with your friends, so that you at least know that they're still around.
Good job.
And after weeks of no face-to-face contact with her classmates, Alice can't wait to get back on the bus again.
There'll be some very excited students when the buses arrive. There'll be some very excited students.
What a great job our educators do. I'm really feeling for those families and kids with special needs.
Yes, and you're right, homeschooling does, it has really made us appreciate even more the incredible work that our educators do, and maybe made our kids complain a little less about going to school now that they've had mum or dad as teacher.
Yeah, good point. We've all been spending a lot more time online at the moment, so how do we handle it with our kids when life goes back to normal? We'll have more on that right after the break here on The House of Wellness. Welcome back. Social distancing has seen an upsurge in online chats and postings like never before. Hundreds of millions of users have signed up to apps like Zoom, Houseparty and TikTok since February this year. Now, Joe, let me ask this. Should anyone over 25 be on TikTok?
I enjoy seeing parents with their kids trying to do the dancing together. I think that's super cute. I do think, though, if you're watching your kids do TikTok, you've got to supervise that, because sometimes they can actually get caught up in things that aren't appropriate.
15-year-old daughter at home, right in the TikTok zone. Yes. And fair to say, I haven't been asked to get involved.
No,
I find it the weirdest thing that I've ever seen, to be honest with you.
I don't know. What, do people get around and they lip sync to some music that's already... I'm too old to explain it. I don't know.
There are just so many platforms. Let's be honest, it's hard for parents to keep an eye on top of all of them. What brings some consolation, though, is that Australia is the only government in the world that has a regulatory agency focused solely on the online safety of its citizens, which is fantastic. And I spoke to Australian eSafety Commissioner Julie Inman-Grant and began by asking her, just how can parents keep our kids safe while surfing the net?
I mean, it's a good question. It's a parents that our own parents didn't have to grapple with. It is 95% of Australian parents we've spoken to have said that online safety is the perennial parenting challenge of our time. And so few parents know where to go, and that's why the eSafety Office was created. But I have a few tips for parents out there, because we've seen, even with COVID, we can't forget that there are benefits of technology. Had the technology not been as advanced, our isolation would have felt all the more stark. We do have video conferencing platforms and other remote learning platforms so that we can continue to learn and we continue to work. But there are benefits and there are risks. So there are a few key things that parents can do to mitigate the risks to their children being online 24/7, 7 days a week. And the first is to set time limitations for our kids and make sure we sit down with them. We have a family technology agreement you can work through on our website so that they know how much time they can spend in during what hours. We also recommend that when kids are online gaming or socializing or for entertainment, that they do so in open areas of the home. We can't forget that when we're opening up the internet through our devices to our children, we're also allowing strangers into our room. So we want to be seeing what they're experiencing, make sure that, you know, things aren't happening behind closed doors that we're not aware of. And that goes to getting engaged in our kids' online lives by co-viewing, co-playing, and talking to them about what they're doing online, who they're speaking to. Now, you can use technology tools like parental controls or privacy settings to help monitor what your kids are doing online and who they're chatting to, but there is no substitute as a parental control for a parental presence in your kids' online lives.
Julie, I've got my 15-year-old daughter's voice ringing in my ears as you're talking. Dad, you're so strict. You're such a loser. I can't believe you're taking my phone off me. Again, it's a battle, because it's an emotional connection, isn't it, to devices. It's such a big part of their world, and it takes a lot of effort and a lot of consistency for parents to follow through.
Yeah, and we sometimes forget that when we were teenagers, we were on the phone with our friends as well. This is how kids are socializing online. And I know it drives a lot of us nuts because we want them out there exercising, balancing, maybe doing a socially distanced walk with their friends. We want to get them out of their rooms and off their devices and engaging with the rest of the world. But this is the brave new world that we're all living in, and that's why these limitations are important.
Hey, Julie, can I ask you what are some of the pressures that kids are under with these video-based platforms?
Well, I've talked to a number of parents who have woken up in the middle of the night and found their teenage girls locked in the bathroom with makeup on to film a TikTok video, girls that don't usually wear makeup. So obviously there's a lot of pressure to conform to certain body image ideals, to look a certain way, to talk a certain way. Again, pressures that we may have faced growing up that are really just amplified by, you know, Instagram influencers and others.
And Julie, it moves so quickly. TikTok's this phenomenon that has emerged, and I can't, you know, quite get my head around that. It looks innocent at one level, but should we be nervous about new technology like TikTok?
Well, if you think about TikTok, it's a combination of Vine and YouTube and, you know, all the other platforms put together, and it can be very fun and creative. But any platform that facilitates social interaction can be misused by people. Really, what we're talking about are human behaviors playing out in an online context. So if your child's on TikTok, make sure that when they download any apps, you're downloading it with them or they require your permission. Well, one, you can make sure that it's age appropriate for your child. They shouldn't be on TikTok before the age of 13. And that you're making sure that you set the right privacy and safety settings and you're setting it up with them. So yes, that can be misused. It can be used for bullying. It can be used by grooming of predators. And what we're really concerned about is when they befriend a stranger. And we know that 1 in 4 Australian teenagers has been approached by a stranger online, is that they don't go off those platforms onto other, I guess, more secure or encrypted messaging platforms.
Wow, what an incredible stat that is, that 1 in 4 kids are approached by a stranger online. And the problem is that parents, as you know, Joe, can't monitor their kids 24/7. And most kids, let's be honest, don't want to talk about what's going on behind closed doors.
It is really hard. Of course, you have to supervise them whenever they're on the screen, but you've got to cook dinner. You've got to do all the different things you do in your household. It is really, really hard.
Yeah, absolutely. The new normal has certainly brought a raft of unprecedented changes, and we'll get some expert predictions on life post-COVID-19 a little later. But up next, we look at the pioneering treatment that saw an Aussie dad beat cancer. That's back after this on The House of Wellness. You're watching The House of Wellness. June 7th is Cancer Survivors Day, and the key word there, Joe, is survive, and that is, for me, a very good reason to celebrate.
Oh, absolutely. Over the past 30 years, there's been so much cancer research and breakthrough treatments. The death rates have fallen by more than 24%. And just as the world races to develop a coronavirus vaccine, advances are also being made relating to cancer.
Aussie father of five, Jeffrey Deslandres, received the diagnosis no one wants to hear back in 1999. After a relapse, he tried an experimental cancer drug that uses a vaccine created by his own immune cells with some incredible results.
I was sitting at work one day in my job at BHP and I breathed in and I had a sharp pain under the ribcage. I thought, that's unusual.
In 1999, 51-year-old Jeffrey Deslandres was a high flyer in the corporate world when suddenly everything changed.
It came as a big shock. I had stage 4 non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, and it was in my bone marrow, in the spleen. I had massive tumours inside my abdomen, and it was really serious. It was like a ton of bricks fell on my head. You know, I'm going to die, you know. Yeah. They said there were two options that would keep coming back each time and then eventually become resistant to chemotherapy, and then I'd probably die from that, or it would transform to a more aggressive cancer more aggressive lymphoma, and which was resistant to treatment, and which I died from that. So there was like two options. None of them were good.
With two rounds of chemotherapy, Jeffrey was given the all clear. But 4 years later, the cancer returned.
I was sitting in bed and I felt a lump here and a lump here. It was Father's Day, I remember. I thought, oh, nice Father's Day present. And yeah, sure enough, it was lymphoma had returned in the groin area on both sides.
After enduring two more rounds of chemo and two further relapses, enough was enough.
I'm a very stubborn person, I guess, and not ready to die, but this is not good. So I thought, we're going to have to outsmart this cancer by looking outside the box. I was in a lymphoma support group in Brisbane, and I'd become aware of some research being done on vaccines for cancer. So I thought, that's what I'm going to do, and it's going to work.
Personalised immunotherapy were vaccines being trialled by a doctor in Brisbane.
He took out a inguinal node from the groin, special blood cells called dendritic cells, and these are processed in a laboratory to make your own body's exact antibody to your cancer. So it's very personalised in that it's not like taking a chemotherapy drug off the shelf and giving it to you based on your body mass index. It has to be your cells outside the laboratory and then given back to you at various times.
After 8 injections in 3 months, the cancer had all but disappeared.
I wasn't that elated because it was just early days. We had to then keep having injections, keep having checks. So, you know, it was 3 months and then it was 6 months. Then it was a year and then it was 2 years. And now we're up to 13 and a half years. I can't really tell you why I chose the vaccine therapy. It just seemed to make perfect sense to me, using your immune system to recognise the cancer and to take it out.
And unlike many cancer treatments, immunotherapy had no side effects.
If anything, you walk out feeling more pumped because you've had 5 million antibodies put into your bloodstream, so you know that they're, you know, running around doing their thing, so you actually feel stronger and more positive when you walked in.
The hikes I've been on, he's better after he has the treatment. Yeah.
And you should see him on the track. He's just off up the hill. He hikes like a 30-year-old.
While keeping fit and eating right, Jeffrey remained healthy and cancer-free. But 18 months ago, that came to an abrupt end.
I was ate a meal one day and I had a feeling of very fullness and I felt very unwell. And they did some tests and they suggested the lymphoma was back. I said, no, there's no way the lymphoma's back. You've got that wrong. And they eventually found a neuroendocrine tumour in the small intestine, the ileum.
Although unrelated to his lymphoma, he knew exactly what to do. But with immunotherapy no longer an option in Australia, it was off to Japan.
So I've been to Japan 3 times now to have treatment, and I remain free of that cancer. I'm amazed now that I'm, you know, almost 72 and I plan to die of old age. Cancer won't be taking me.
With the world understandably focused on a COVID-19 vaccine, it's really heartening to see that there is progress in other fields as well, Darce.
Yeah, too true, and there's a lot going on. Last year saw major breakthroughs in a possible blood test for breast cancer, along with a new drug to treat cystic fibrosis and Alzheimer's.
Of course, we can all do our very small bit to help keep the community disease-free by simply washing our hands, and that's never going to go away. And with all that washing and cleaning, what better time to give our hard-working hands an at-home pamper?
Hi, I'm Jay Kisnorbo, and I'm all about the latest beauty, hair and makeup trends.
And I'm Polly Harding, and working in radio, I've still got a lot to learn about the beauty biz.
Together, we're going to bust those beauty myths,
strip things back to basics, and learn a few new tricks in the process. Well, it's no secret that we're all washing our hands a lot at the moment. My fingers have flared up with my eczema. Like, I've been doing it that much. But you know what? We're all heroes. We're doing our bit. But I think it's important we get a little bit of TLC.
So I don't know about you, but I've never had a break from SNS or all these things that we add to our nails and beauty treatments we get. And I think now this is the time that's forced us to let our nails breathe and recover almost. So it's a real important time to go and purchase the products that actually help with our nail health. So, PJ, if you take away anything today, it's about following the steps with nails. The first step, and one that many people forget, is actually to apply a hardener first. Mm-hmm. So this is great in protecting your nails and overall nail health. Now the part of choosing the colour.
Yay!
The funnest bit.
So this is where you get to express yourself. Maybe 100%. You're feeling, you know, sophisticated or a little bit quirky.
It's like choosing the favourite lip shade, nail shade. It lifts the mood. I love that. What colour is that?
That is 230 pink cardamom.
Oh, very nice.
Over a pink cardamom today.
I love that.
This colour looks natural.
It looks beautiful. The thing about our nails are they're porous. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people are really mindful, I think more now than ever, of what you're placing onto your nails.
Right.
And I think the great thing about the Sally Hansen range is that it's 10-free. So it's a new terminology, but it's being free of parabens.
Formaldehyde, all the nasties.
Exactly. It's actually vegan and plant-based.
Which is why this range is called Good, Kind, Pure.
It's really important not to miss a step. So if it is that you're first putting on a hardening coat or something to harden and strengthen your nails, it's really important also to end it with a top coat and not miss one or the other out.
Ta-da!
There's something I get when I see that final coat on there.
It makes them look so much better, and I think that's what I was missing for so many years. I was like,
you can't have the nail polish without the final coat. It just locks in the colour, the pigment is stronger. Looks great.
It's the best job I've ever done.
Ever?
But I don't want to speak too soon, because normally I put my finger in something because I forget that they're still wet.
I know, so. That's the worst, isn't it?
You're watching The House of Wellness. 2020 has seen life as we know it change forever, and a recent national survey confirmed that 86% of Aussies have already altered their behaviour, and 1 in 20 of us don't believe that life will ever go back to the way it was, Jo.
Well, while the global pandemic has left us all feeling shell-shocked, most of us agree this is a real opportunity for positive change in the way we work, consume, travel and interact. It's a chance to stop and reassess what's truly important to us.
Mark McCrindle is an expert analyst whose company tracks emerging social issues and trends. Let's hear his predictions for what our life post-coronavirus would or could look like.
What would you say are the key changes you've observed that you consider will continue post-corona?
Well, the first would be working from home. I mean, how profound has that been? We found that 2 in 3 Australians who could work from home have worked from home. And again, with no preparation time, this was almost overnight. In fact, you know something has become a thing when it's got an acronym, and WFH is now an acronym people use, working from home. It's just become mainstream for us. We found that 7 in 10 Australians say that some continuation of working from home will be the new normal. We were juggling more roles than we probably could as a society. The Australian Bureau of Statistics data on this says that more than 3 in 5 Australians prior to this COVID slowdown felt that they were often or always rushed or pressed for time. Now, that's not a sustainable pace. And this has brought all of that to a screeching halt. And I think having experienced this, we've got some level of sustainability back into our calendar and indeed financial sustainability that comes from that. And we won't want to let go of that too quickly as well. So I think that new pace of life will be with us for a while as well.
Do you imagine, though, that the old pace of life is not going to just slowly creep up on us?
You're right, and it will creep back, but the creep will be slower than we might think. We're not eager to rush back into the exact same pace that we did have. Now, we want to increase the pace that we've got currently because there's only so long we can sort of spend within our homes or playing a bit of activity in the backyard. But we will want to keep something of what we've experienced now, which was more time with family. We found 1 in 5 Australians have enjoyed and built stronger bonds within their household because of corona.
Do you expect, and I certainly hope, that as a society, we come out of this being aware of how resilient we can be?
Yeah, definitely. And I think particularly for the younger generation, an experience like this is formative for them. You know, the older generation can talk about the impact of the war years. We hear stories from grandparents or earlier of the depression years and how it forged a generation. we got into a period where we just took everything for granted, and we thought we could flip from one job to the next, that there were more jobs than people. We thought that, hey, the stock market only goes one way, and that's up. We thought that who needs savings? You can put it all on credit or Afterpay or whatever, because we're going to earn more in the future than we do today. And suddenly this has told us that's not the case.
What about our understanding of hygiene, which I'm sure we all had before this, but now I must say I've become a bit of a germaphobe. I'm more aware of how many people I'm mixing with. And as we return to normal life, can you imagine us ever being on a crowded train again or at the football again?
It will take some time. The impacts of this have been very deep, not just in our behaviours, but in our psyche. We are going to have to navigate the new terrain. Now, I don't think that anxiety is going to be there forever. There will be some new approaches into the medium term, maybe some things permanently for the long term, but certainly it is going to take some time to get back to normal. And most Australians are saying, and I back them in this, that 2020 is going to be, for the rest of the year, different. Maybe in 2021, we'll start to get back to how some of our social interactions or workplace practices were, although, again, for safety reasons, increasing the cleaning, the hand washing, having basins or washing facilities at restaurants, or new approaches to buffets, and no more shared biscuit jars at the office. I think some of these things will be permanent realities moving forward.
We're watching that. There seems to be, Joe, two schools of thought. Either our time at home has made us closer to our families, more productive, and we're keen to keep working remotely, or it's made us desperately want to get back to the workplace for some time out. Now, let me ask you, which camp do you fall into?
Oh, no, I'm loving my time at home with my baby and my husband. I don't want to go back to normal really? So quickly, no. I think we can find some balance there. What about you?
A little bit of both. We've had a great time at home, just about ready to get back into life as normal. Now, getting back to a simpler life and cutting back on consumption has to be a great outcome out of some of those predictions, but not all of them were positive, Joe. Crowded public transport took a beating in favour of travelling by car, which, let's be honest, isn't great news for the environment.
Well, I'll be sad if that happens to us, because I really love catching the train, so I'm not ready to let that go yet. But I've tried to use the time productively, and that's with podcasting. I'm very excited to say that the podcast I co-host with the incredible mindfulness coach Emma Murray goes live this week on June the 12th. It's called Best of You in the House of Wellness. You must check it out.
Congratulations, Joe, since I cannot wait to listen to it. Emma Murray is just a superstar. And you've got the incredible sprinter Morgan Mitchell as your first guest. She's amazing as well. Tell us about that.
She is incredible. She's a super talented runner. She's currently training for the Tokyo Olympics next year. We expect that will be happening, I'm assuming.
Fingers crossed.
Fingers crossed, yes. But in our podcast, Morgan tells us that she was so crippled, and this is all happening behind the facade of her incredible confidence and bubbliness. She was so crippled by self-doubt and fear of other people's opinions that it almost cost her career.
Really looking forward to hearing that, Jo. Sounds great. Well, this time has definitely been a great chance to slow down, be more present and mindful, and even up the kitchen skills. And here to bring us their healthy cooking methods is Hinesy and Gerald Quigley.
GQ, you're going to want to watch really closely as I whip this delicious salmon and pumpkin fish cakes together. They're so easy, but really delicious. And I tell you what, you can make a big batch of this batter. If you don't use it all, put it in the freezer and you can cook it next time.
Hunter, you won't need to freeze any today because there's me, there's the crew, and you use salmon so much in your cooking. You must love it.
Oh, I love salmon. Perfect with crispy skin. Otherwise, you can poach it like this recipe and it's really versatile. You can put it in pretty much anything and it's packed with heaps of nutrients.
Well, the nutrients in there are important for our whole body, for our brain, our muscles and our bones.
Say what? What's the last one you covered off?
Well, the nutrients in salmon are calcium and vitamin D, which are really important for our bone health. Do you know, you and I have over 200 bones in our body and we need to look after every single one of them.
They are integral to overall good health, GQ. I mean, they help us move, they protect our vital organs and they store minerals and fat. Now, hang tight. I just want to put these on the heat.
So while you're doing that, Hinesy, let me tell you how calcium and vitamin D work together to help our bone strength. So calcium is important for bone mineral density and bone strength, but the vitamin D helps us absorb the calcium and actually use it better. And that's why they work so beautifully together.
So you're saying you can have adequate amounts of calcium, but if you're deficient in vitamin D, it might be going to waste or vice versa?
Yeah, that's true, Hines. And unfortunately, 73% of Australian women don't get enough calcium from their food options. And one in four of us have insufficient levels of vitamin D. So using them together, as in your salmon fish cakes, or in supplement form, is very, very important.
GQ, it sounds like they're a bit of a dream team, really.
It's like you and me in the kitchen, Hinesy, or Batman and Robin for bones.
Well, that's going to definitely make me Batman, right, GQ?
You really? No, Robin, I'm Batman.
The A to Z of Vitamins is brought to you by Oftalon, Australia's number one bone health brand.
Welcome back. We've been talking a lot in recent weeks about home projects. And Joe, I know you've been using your time constructively, getting your home and life in order. Have you gone the whole way and done the big sort of clean out style or not?
No, I am no Marie Kondo. My house is still a complete shambles because that's the way I like it. Marie Kondo is all about joy and I find joy in junk.
Really?
So there you go.
How about that? Does he enjoy that or
not? Oh, he's a hoarder. Oh, my God, he's worse.
Well, one thing we've done at home, Joe, is clean out a lot of stuff, but all the recycling and op shops are just starting to reopen their doors, so you can go and find those fabulous neon jackets from the 90s and the turtleneck jumpers, Joe.
I love that stuff. There's going to be so much awesome special finds there at those op shops, and I'm all for it. But if you are looking for somewhere to recycle, take a look at Man Rags. They're one of a growing number of ethical businesses on a mission to reduce waste and landfill and prove that the best colour when it comes to fashion is green.
In 2015, I was working in the corporate world and I started wearing some funky socks, some colourful socks, and meetings became more about my socks than they were about how we could, you know, increase sales revenue and marketing approaches, and you know, that's where I fell in love with the socks.
As Michael Elias's collection grew, he decided just wearing cool socks wasn't enough. With his wife Tina, he left the corporate life behind and started up his very own sock brand.
So a lot of skeptics, a lot of people laughed. I think even my parents thought that I was out of my mind. This, you know, a fantastic banking career that I had was giving it all up to, you know, try and sell socks. But, you know, 4 years on, we have thousands of subscribers all over the world. We're, you know, in 70 countries all over the world. And then last year, as we had, you know, seen all this fantastic growth, we started questioning what happens to our socks when our customers are done with them. And, you know, I think we asked some of our community, but we also asked ourselves, and there's nothing to do with them but, you know, put them in the bin. So we introduced what became known as the world's first sock recycling initiative, called Start With Socks, and people from all over the country could jump online, purchase a satchel from us, which we would send them. They would fill that up with their old unwanted socks, and they would just drop that into any Australia Post box in the country, and it would land back at our warehouse.
Within 6 months, Man Rags saved 600,000 pairs of socks from going into landfill. But a few months ago, as Australia went into lockdown, Michael saw an opportunity to make an even bigger difference.
We said to ourselves, well, you know, this is not all doom and gloom. Actually, there is a number of people at home, whilst they're at home isolating, quarantining, whatever it is, this is a great opportunity for them to clear out their wardrobe and for us to ensure that their clothes don't end up in landfill.
Practically overnight, Man Rags launched their most ambitious project yet, allowing isolated Aussies to send them not just their old socks, but every unwanted item in their wardrobe.
There's three phases that happen once we receive the product. There is a reuse, repurpose, or recycle. Recycling sees us then break it down into materials, into colours, and then shredded and turned into new yarn to be brought back into the economy without having to manufacture and farm, you know, new product.
Man Rags even provide a contactless pickup service. By the end of lockdown, they had collected 35,000 kilos of material. preventing over 150,000 kilos of greenhouse gas emissions.
Unforeseen, unfortunate circumstances have created a great opportunity for us to do good by the planet, so can't complain and quite happy with that.
Well, the company has diverted almost 30 tonnes of clothing and shoes from landfill, including more than 500,000 socks. I bet they are all mismatched single socks, Joe, which is why is it so hard to keep a pair together?
Look, it is one of life's greatest mysteries, Darce, that British scientists actually looked into a few years back. They discovered that we each lose an average of 15 socks a year, which adds up to 11 to 1,200 socks in our lifetimes.
Well, I can't believe someone actually did a study into that, Joe.
Oh, look, it must have been something that really bothered that scientist. So what is your choice of sock, Darce? Are you into those happy socks? They're super cute.
I must admit, I did have a lucky pair of socks I used to wear to the game every time I played footy. Then I couldn't find them one morning of the game. It stressed me out big time. So no more superstitions after that, Joe.
Did you win the game?
Can't even remember. But I remember saying I'm never going to have a lucky pair of socks again.
Well, one man who's in fashion whatever the season, although I have no idea what kind of socks he wears, is House of Wellness resident pharmacist and herbalist Gerald Quigley, this time with some tips on keeping our skin hydrated despite the drying winter chill.
Ryan, our skin is the largest organ in our body, but how can that change over time?
The skin is a very interesting dynamic organ. So certainly as we grow and change with age and with hormonal influences, as well as the environmental factors, our skin changes quite a lot.
Dermatologist Dr. Ryan De Cruz treats all kinds of skin conditions.
I'd estimate over 60% of my patients present with symptoms of dry skin, so complaining of symptoms like itch, sensitivity, red skin or scaly skin. That means that our skin barrier isn't functioning properly and results in inflammation.
You've mentioned the skin barrier. Tell us a little more about that.
Yeah, so the skin barrier is a phrase that we use to describe the final frontier between our body and our internal organs and the outside world. So our skin cells are held together by a very important cement made up of ingredients called ceramides. If our skin is deficient in ceramide, our skin barrier doesn't work properly. So the skin cells separate out, allowing water to evaporate off our skin and allowing irritants to come in and aggravate our skin.
What can we do to reduce the risk of dry skin and to maintain that skin barrier?
So the most important thing is to use a soap-free cleanser whenever we do shower, but also in our bathrooms, in our kitchens, whenever we're washing our hands. Soap-free cleansers are actually as good as soap at removing dirt and grime and bacteria, but actually help maintain our skin barrier much better. Immediately after cleansing, I always recommend moisturising. Having a good hand moisturiser in the kitchen and the bathroom, but also having a good tub of moisturiser in the bathroom for after use in the showers.
So we should be looking for skin-friendly ingredients, and especially ingredients that are able to support the skin's barrier and boost hydration. So to give you some examples, lipids, and these are ingredients like ceramides and fatty acids. Products with ceramides can be beneficial for everyone. They can be suitable for everyone, but especially those with dry, irritated skin. So MVE technology is able to progressively deliver the hydrating ingredients throughout the day. So having MVE technology in a formulation can be quite useful, especially for those people that aren't able to apply their skincare, you know, 3 to 4 to 5 times a day, which is what's often advised when you have dry, irritated skin. So other qualities to look for in a skincare formulation would be fragrance-free, overall a non-irritating formula. Sometimes less ingredients is a good thing as well. Also a formulation that is non-greasy. We want people to actually wear their skincare.
Ryan, an important message here from you is that it's cleansing and moisturising. Could we then say, Ryan, that cleansing and moisturising is working hand in hand?
Absolutely, Gerald.
Welcome back. A few weeks ago, nutritionist and self-confessed herb nerd Rhys Carter took us through some of his favourite plants, Joe, and I know you're a big fan of basil.
Oh, I do love basil with some beautiful tomato. Yum, yum, yum. And I also am a huge fan of ginger with winter almost here. And Rhys has a natural homemade remedy that's perfect to soothe a sore throat.
Cold season is around the corner, and if you're anything like me, one of the most annoying things to come with it is a sore throat. So I'm going to show you how to make my homemade all-natural honey, ginger and lemon lozenges for when you catch a cold. Start with half a cup of good quality honey and pop it into a small saucepan. Honey is naturally soothing for the throat, and some varieties may even have antibacterial properties. This is our hero ingredient. This is ginger, fresh ginger, and we're going to start by getting a piece about this size and just peeling that skin off. Now, if you've ever had ginger tea before, you know how warm it is, and that feels fantastic on a sore throat. Of course, you can just make a fresh ginger tea, stir through some honey and a squeeze of lemon, but making lozenges like this is a really handy way to have a supply ready to go should you or the rest of the family need them. It's about a tablespoon of really finely grated ginger that we need, and that goes in with the honey. Lastly, lemon. We need about half a lemon, and we're just going to squeeze this straight into the saucepan as well. Want to give it a really good stir to combine all of those ingredients. And what we're essentially doing today is we're going to make a toffee. So we'll pop it on the stove. This is going to take about 15, 20 minutes. And you just want to keep it stirring, keep an eye on it, so that it doesn't bubble up too much or even worse, burn. The way to test if this is ready is a bowl of water with some ice in it and drop it straight in. Now, if it turns solid when it hits the water, which this has, that means it's ready and time to turn into our lozenges. As soon as you've taken it off the heat, just leave it a couple of minutes just to thicken up slightly. And then we're going to spoon it out with a teaspoon onto baking paper, trying as much as possible to make them even and round. They're gonna end up a little bit rustic. That's part of the beauty of them. After about half an hour to an hour, they'll set like little toffees, but they will be quite sticky. So our last step is to coat them in corn flour. You can also use ground cinnamon just to keep them from sticking together. And then you can just store them in somewhere cool and dry. They'll last a couple of days.
So Joe, are you a fan of home remedies like chicken soup for a cold or a spoonful of sugar or honey to stop the hiccups?
I do have what I call a little witch's brew that I make when I've got a very, very sore throat, which is as much garlic and ginger as you cope with lemon and honey all just sort of brewed for about 10 minutes and then you've got to just down it.
And then stay away from you.
It's remarkable no one comes near me for a week.
Well, that's our show for today. Head to our website, houseofwellness.com.au, for more information about the show. Tune into the House of Wellness radio show every Sunday with Joe Stanley and GQ. As always, thanks to our great friends at Chemist Warehouse. Stay safe, stay well, and we'll see you next time.